Anytime you're ready, we're gonna, so continuing our discussion of the skew T diagram, we're gonna focus on the wind profile, because when we talk about organized severe thunderstorms, the Hodograph is our best tool in our toolbox to understand what it is about the wind profile that allows particular storm structures to be formed and maintained. So a Hodograph and vertical shear, again, I'll put it in words and then we'll show it if you haven't seen a Hodograph or thought about it. It's just, think of, you start with a polar plot, take the endpoint of every wind vector, plot them as a vector, and then the Hodograph just connects the endpoints of all the vectors as you move up in the atmosphere. And you can actually, because of what you're doing, is if you go from the endpoint of one vector to another one, that's a vector difference, that's actually a vertical shear, is what you've done. So anything moving along the Hodograph is actually a way to measure vertical shear. So naturally, I pick a nice curved Hodograph. This is typical of a tornadic supercell environment. And we will look at here, this is the surface wind. So all we're doing is from this plot, the surface wind is out of the south-southeast at about 15 knots. So the end point of that is the starting point of the Hodograph. Go up to 1 kilometer. And if you can see there, we've got the ones and twos, the little bitty white numbers would represent the height in kilometers above ground level. So the wind at 1 kilometer is out of the south at roughly 50 knots. So there's a big change in the wind just in that lowest, you know, few thousand, couple of hundred meters, and then 2 kilometers it goes to southwest and it stays around 50. Okay, so what we've done is you just take all the winds all through here and you just plot them all, and that's the Hodograph is the resulting trace of the end of all those wind vectors. All right, now you can get vertical shear is inherently what the Hodograph tells you, because this is essentially a bunch of shear vectors is what it really represents. So from a Hodograph, if you want the surface to 2 kilometer above ground level shear, you just draw the vector between those two. And if you take the length of this vector, this one's easy enough to eyeball. What does that look like? About 50 knots if you translate it down to the axis. So there's about 50 knots of vertical shear, bulk wind shear, in the lowest 2 kilometers. You can do this from any level. We can start at 1 and go all the way. If you follow the numbers up, this is the 9 kilometer AGL level. That's the shear vector from 1 to 9. Nothing, you know, particularly meaningful about that one by itself, but you can see the vertical shear, it's a longer vector, so the shear through that layer is even stronger. Now there's other things, storm relative winds are important. We're using an assumed right moving supercell motion here. That's the, anyone's heard of the bunkers motion or the internal dynamics method. That's what we're using here. And the storm relative wind is just the vector from the storm motion back to the Hodograph at whatever level you're interested in. So if, in this case, I'm drawing the storm relative wind at the surface is out of the east-northeast. So it's back to the Hodograph. Now there's, anyone that's familiar with Hodographs, there's something very interesting about this Hodograph shape and that storm relative wind. Notice it's about perpendicular to the orientation of the Hodograph right down near the ground. Well, anyone's familiar with the right-hand rule, these are shear vectors, so you're going up in height. So if we take there up around 1 kilometer and you use your fingers on your right hand point in the direction of the vertical shear, which is up or along the Hodograph, in this case it would be pointing toward the right or the east, your thumb on your right hand, assuming yours is any more messed up than mine from flag football in the day, it points to the north. That's the vorticity vector. So the vorticity vector is always perpendicular to and to the left of the Hodograph, like this. Now think about that when we're looking down in the near the surface layer. Your fingers are pointing toward the north-northwest, the vorticity vector's toward the west-southwest. This is what we call almost pure streamwise vorticity. The storm relative wind is oriented parallel to and in the same direction as the vorticity vector. So this is a case that's, when we start talking about storm relative helicity, when you see streamwise vorticity like this, it's very easy to get tilting and stretching of vorticity into the vertical, which is related to the whole supercell process. So I'm gonna hit that again. We're gonna go back over this and show real world examples of how it applies. Point is, you need to know the mechanics of the Hodograph to make sense of that. And then of course, when we talk something like storm relative helicity, it's literally just proportional to the area swept out. You just pick some depth. In this case, those blue lines are just the effective inflow layer, which is just the layer where we lift all the parcels, and it's contiguous, so somewhere between 1 and 2 kilometers above the ground. you get buoyancy with every lifted parcel in there. And then once you get up to about 2 kilometers, it dries out in the temperature and moisture profile, and there's no more cape resulting from those. So what we call the effective inflow layer, and I'll talk about that a little bit more later, it's proportional to this area that's swept out. So that's what storm relative felicity would be. When you have streamwise vorticity, you tend to you almost have to have storm motions way off the hodograph like this one, and you tend to have this characteristic sickle shape to the hodograph in the low levels. They're all related. It's just different ways to say the same thing. Okay, so the sounding diagrams, obviously you look at temperature and moisture profiles, you get capes and all the thermodynamic variables, but again, the vertical shear from the hodograph, instead of just eyeballing a bunch of wind barbs, you can actually trace the vertical shear out, and it'll help you determine, can we get supercells in this profile, or will they just be, quote, ordinary storms? And all of the parameters that I know you guys look at least the weather weenie types, they are all derived from this. If you don't understand the lifted parcels, you don't understand the thermodynamic diagram, and you have no idea what vertical shear means or how to deal with a hodograph, then you are flying blind. And again, in 10 minutes, I'll go automate you. If all you're going to do is, oh, well, this model shows this value X at this location, therefore, that's not being a meteorologist. That's just trying to shortchange yourself. So I want you to understand, how do we get these values? And again, we're going to talk about that in more detail with respect to supercells and tornadoes.